Hello. I'll be pressing a case series of piggyback surgery in non-ophthalmic patients. Cataract surgery is something like fishing. Sometimes it's like removing a small fish out of a pot. Sometimes it's removing a big fish out of a small pot. And piggyback surgery is like putting back two fishes. In the scheme of eyes, if you see 1.8% of eyes are non-ophthalmic. I'm pressing a series of cases of non-ophthalmic patients in which we did piggyback surgery. My first patient is a 71-year-old male who presented to us with a vision of 1/60, improving up to 660. And at the time of presentation, he had a nuclear sclerosis of 3, grade 3 in the right eye and grade 2 in the left. This is his fundus picture showing pigmentary changes in the fundus and a small cup disc ratio and the corresponding OCT showing the pachychoroids. His biometry showed an axial length of 16 millimeters with a K reading of 52 and 49 diopters, effectively bringing a required IOL power for this patient of 50 diopters. So this brought us to a dilemma, what IOL to use. Either we can put the maximum available IOL, do a piggyback surgery, or make a custom IOL. Since at the time of surgery, making a custom IOL or affording it was not an option, we considered the other two options. The first option is to give a maximum IOL, that is 40 diopters, which will bring a residual of 10.5. which in spectacle plane would again bring 6 diopters. So we thought we'll correct the power residual with a piggyback surgery. So we re-evaluated the biometry. If you see, in a 16.5 millimeter eye, 5.66 is the lens nucleus size. That is 33% of the whole volume is the nucleus. And we have enough space to accommodate two IOLs. This is a short surgical video. In this case, we approached two ways. We made a sclerocorneal tunnel superiorly, did the phaco through a sclerocorneal incision, made the rexus. After nuclear emulsification, we introduced a 40 diopter foldable IOL into the bag, did a double rexus to expand the rexus, and after which we opened the tunnel and introduced a three-piece IOL, which was rigid, into the bag, meticulously washed visco between and within the bag. This is the 1 month post-op in which the patient achieved his maximum best corrected 660. Since amblyopia and pigmentary changes hampered the assessment of vision subjectively, we did an objective assessment with AIOC2020, biometry, and aberrometry. This is the AIOC2020 of the patient showing that his anterior chamber depth had improved from 1.92 to almost double of 4.09. And this can be seen in biometry values as well. And this is the aberrometry showing that his residual sphere was only 1 diopter with a cylinder of 0.3, bringing the spherical equivalent to 0.82. Comparing this to the other eye, which had 8 diopter sphere. Not only this, the visual stimulated analogs showed that the comparison of vision quality in the right eye is much better than the contralateral eye. Coming to my second case, which is a 65-year-old lady, again presented with 1/60 in the right eye, 624 in the left. She had almost grade 3 to 4 nuclear sclerosis in the right eye. Again, she had dilated tortuous veins and pigmentary changes and a pachychoroid in the fundus picture. Again, the required power in this case was 54 diopters. In this case, since it was quite dilated, we approached with a single clear corneal incision. Again, the nucleus was stained, the rexus was done, the nucleus was emulsified, and again the first time we put the highest available power, 40 diopters, within the bag. After which, a foldable three-piece IOL acrylic again was introduced, this time within the bag. And again, visco was meticulously washed. So 1 month post-op, this is the patient achieving a best corrected of 612. Again, we did a subjective and objective assessment. This is the nucleus thickness in this patient, which had reduced from initial 4.38 to 1.16, even with two IOLs within the bag. And the anterior chamber again doubled from 2.67 to 4.39. This again is the subjective refraction showing the final sphere was only 0.04 and this cylinder was the part, because this time we did not make a sclerocorneal tunnel, so that cylinder was still present in the keratometry, bringing the spherical equivalent to 0.59 diopters. Again, comparing to the other eye, which has 12 diopters, and you can see the points spread function, which is widely distributed, bringing the simulated vision, which is much better in the right eye. Finally, this is my last two cases. One, this is a lady who presented to us with nanophthalmos, and at the time of presentation, her axial lengths were 16.9 and 16.8 in right and left eye. She went for a custom IOL in the right eye, but the result of the custom IOL was unsatisfactory. So for the next eye, we did a piggyback surgery. This is a patient who required custom IOL 47 diopter in the right and 48 diopter piggyback in the left. If you can see the comparison of Swebsev's OCT, this is the right eye, the first one, which has an anterior chamber depth of 2.64 in the center. And the piggyback eye with two IOLs still has almost double 4.48 anterior chamber depth. This is a simulated aberrometry showing that a refraction in the piggyback eye was only 0.5 diopters PR. But this is a two-year-old result. You can see the right eye, which has a peripheral shallow anterior chamber, though the center is good. And the other eye is the piggyback eye 2 years later, even without much any PCO or anything even between the IOLs. And the vision quality was much better in 6/18 in the left eye. But unfortunately for her, the right eye, because of the shallow chamber, had a progressive glaucoma, which required initially AGM and finally a trabeculectomy. But even the piggyback eye, it was well maintained with no glaucomatous change. This is my last case. This is a family of three sisters, out of which one sister had already lost two of her eyes to uveal effusion. When she presented to us in 2014, she had uveal effusion in the right eye, underwent vortex vein decompression, and subsequently, once she came to our cataract services in 2019, her required IOL power for a 15.2 diopter eye with 4 diopter of keratometric astigmatism was 65 diopters. And then this is her 1 month post-op. You can see this is the point spread function and the simulated vision in the left eye. The final sphere was only 1.5 diopters. The keratometric astigmatism of eye cylinders remained, and the quality of vision was much better. To conclude, though piggyback surgery in nanophthalmos might make the surgeon like fish out of water, with meticulous planning and in the hands of a skilled surgeon, we can achieve good results for the patient. Thank you. At the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Kalpana Madam for giving me the opportunity to present these cases. Thank you.
Hello. Regarding the nanophthalmos, the two issues that the narrow anterior chamber and most of the time they may require the vitreous aspiration and, as you mentioned, the vortex vein compression.
Yes, sir.
And another issue here is that because the very high plus power, they are bulky lenses. So yes, the injector system has to be altered, or they are probably not, even a customized eye, they're going to be thicker lenses.
Yes, sir. That
so is this could be a novel idea of putting one lens over the other, either in the bag or in the sulcus. That leaves us with two things. What the question of IOL rotation. No, anyhow, we are not giving any toric ones, but what about the tilt? Because the two IOLs are there, and it is a spherical surface.
So we expect
a tilt. Yes, sir. That is why usually we aligned with both the haptics 90 degrees to each other.
90 degrees to each other.
So
that's
it
good.
Will adhere nicely. And
that's
one
fine.
Of the cases, we put it in the bag. It has gone, when it phimosis, it compresses itself, and the center optical zone will be very good.
So what about the one in the sulcus? Did you see? Because here,
actually, first case was sulcus, and
yes,
in the Swebsev's OCT, we can see the center is still opposed. We didn't expect that, but in a five.
It didn't cause any sulcus irritation and irritative glaucoma and things like that.
Yes, sir. No.
Because the other eye, one of the eyes, you said that is gone in for glaucoma.
That was a custom IOL. It was a
despite customized.
Custom single piece. So custom had a bad result actually, because it was a bulky IOL and injector mechanism is not there. We had to introduce it inside. But center might look okay, but the periphery just jumps forward when in phimosis.
Yeah, in patients with pre-existing very shallow chamber,
yes,
do you do routinely pars plana vitrectomy?
No, in these cases, none of them actually, we gave only mannitol and we did the cases. Fortunately, we were expecting, we had backup retina services, then only we took these cases. We even thought about giving a sclerotomy prior to the surgery, but all these cases, with God's grace, we didn't require any problem, and that is why we intended to put the 40 diopter initially. What is the best available first shot we can give? And if at all some uveal effusion happens, we can stop the surgery and maybe think about the second.
What is the least axial length in these
15, sir. 15. 65 diopters.
You were lucky, but prophylactic posterior sclerotomy is a must when you are dealing with anophthalmic eyes.
Yes, sir.
You might be lucky, but there are a lot of studies proven already that we need to do.
So we have a series we compared, sir, with okay. our retina department. Mm-hmm. But five of our cases, you are lucky.
So maybe institutional, that's the two things I initially told, no? Starting, the prophylactic vitrectomy and those bulky lenses. These are the two issues, small anterior chamber. Because yours is a setup where they can manage with the antecedent complication. But the general teaching is that you do a prophylactic vitrectomy. That saves a lot of problems.